Hi, I'm Travis, and this is Curious Tangents, and this is Max, a German Shepherd. There's a story often told that humans domesticated from wolves, dogs, and that story is kind of a lie, although it's not the biggest lie in human history. More on that later. For now, what I want to know is, are humans domesticated? So, fun fact, in 218 BCE, Hannibal, general of Carthage, led his army through the Alps to attack Rome, and included in that army were 40 war elephants. War elephants that were tamed, not domesticated. Tamed being used lightly, of course, their job was murder. Despite having war elephants, Hannibal lost that war, although he may have won it if he had had domesticated war elephants. Things that would be more obedient. Domesticated animals have an interesting series of differences from their wild counterparts. In theory, of course, you can't actually domesticate an elephant because elephants are undomesticatable. Very few animals are able to be domesticated. A single elephant would take a ridiculous amount of resources. On top of that, elephants are not very fecund. They can't have more than one calf at a time. They also have lifespans comparable to that of a human, and so you can't accurately pass down all of the data within the lifetime of one elephant because the human who was looking after it will likely be gone. That being said, domesticated animals have some really interesting differences from their wild counterparts, and the science behind that is so cool. So that thing appearing on your screen right now is called a mouflon. And it's thought to be where domesticated sheep were domesticated from. Notice that it has horns and is not nearly as fluffy. Most sheep lack horns and are incredibly fluffy and are fatter, all things that will tend to be the trend with domesticated animals. Cows came from now extinct wild oxen, and pigs came from wild boars, which had tusk and plainer fur. A really interesting thing about domesticated pigs, if an uncastrated male pig is released back into the wild, it becomes something called a feral hog. It looks like a mix between its wild ancestor and its domesticated version. There's no true consensus on why this happens, though it appears to be epigenetics, or the environment working on your genes, or the pig's genes. The reason for the changes from wild to domestic, though, are due to a thing called neural crest cells. The difference between the wild animals and their domesticated counterparts is because of a thing called domestication syndrome, and it has to do with their neural crest cells. Neural crest cells are one of the first cells that the developing body develops. During the embryonic phases, they go off to create things like connective tissue and bone and endocrine cells. In this way, they're a whole lot like stem cells. Some of these cells will become adrenal glands. Adrenaline is what triggers a fight or flight response. More aggressive, high-strung, or flighty animals and people tend to have more adrenaline. Animals who produced less adrenaline would have been ripe for domestication, as humans consciously and diligently selected the animals that were friendliest and, in most cases, largest to reproduce. The gene pool for these neural crest cells was altered. The prevalence of neural crest cells, the things that make up the adrenal glands, were turned down. But neural crest cells do more than just make up adrenaline glands. They also make up the cartilage in the ears, which is why so many domesticated animals have floppy ears while their wild counterparts had ears that stood straight up. There are many other differences that domesticated animals have. All of these changes fall under a category called domestication syndrome. And there are two other important things that relate to humans. One is neoteny. Neoteny, also called juvenilization if you enjoy syllables. Neoteny is the retention of premature features in a mature organism, which essentially means adults look baby-ish. This is another comparison that's easily shown with dogs and wolves. A full-grown dog is far more puppy-like than a full-grown wolf. And lastly, brain size. German Shepherds, although very intelligent dogs, have smaller brains than do wolves. The same feature is found in wild boars and pigs. Wild boars have bigger brains than do pigs. Sheep, who famously have small brains, have smaller brains than their wild counterpart, the mouflon. Over the last 10,000 or so years, the brain size of the average human being has been shrinking. Now, there are many reasons for this, most likely. One of the main ones being that the average body size has shrunk from 10,000 years ago. In fact, some psychologists think that smaller brains are actually preferred for some tasks. Things like computation could be done faster with a smaller brain because smaller brains have shorter connection pathways. The reason that this brain shrinkage occurs in domesticated animals is because domesticated animals don't need to use their brains as much. Max is an intelligent dog, though he will never have to plan out a cooperative hunt in order to get his dinner, and so he needs a little bit less brain power than his wolf counterpart, who must do that or die. A change that happened roughly 10,000 years ago was the agricultural revolution, where about 10 to 12,000 years ago, humanity collectively learned how to farm, essentially the bedrock of society. We can build cities and states and nation states and countries because we learned how to farm and work together in large group settlements. Except that's not how that happened. For the previous 2.5 million years, humans, though not anatomically modern humans, did not control what was done by the plants that they gathered or what the animals they hunted did. They hunted and they gathered and they moved nomadically. Until about 12 to 10,000 years ago, humanity began to settle down. Those same hunter-gatherers learned how to farm, and farming allowed them to have an excess of food. They became smart enough to control nature around them. They bred the most docile wild boars together until we had pigs. They built villages, and then city-states, and then empires, and those villages would be the groundwork for the cities that we now live in today. This is the biggest lie in history. The agricultural revolution was not a revolution. It was more like the agricultural accident. Humanity did not gain intelligence 12,000 years ago. There's no evidence for that. On top of that, people didn't drop what they were doing to become agriculturalists. It wasn't sudden, it wasn't planned, and those who did it could not have known what would have resulted from their actions. On top of even that, the initial condition caused by the agricultural revolution was one of increased misery. While the agricultural revolution did cause a surplus in food, it also caused a surplus in population at an exponential rate, meaning that famines are now a possibility. Hunter-gatherers didn't have famines. Whenever one source of food fell short, they simply hunted or gathered something else. They always had varied diets, whereas agriculturalists could spend tons of time farming just one particular crop. If a fungus hits your cornfields and all you have is cornfields, then ancient agriculturalists die in droves. The average farmer would work harder than the average hunter and get less in return for it. So you may be asking, why would they continue to do this? This happened 10,000 years ago. Written language has existed for no more than 3,500 years ago. Imagine that you were born into the society that you live in now, except there's no written records of how society got to be that way. All you have is your parents, and what they tell you about the world, and what their parents told them about the world. In a world where one person's work equals one person's food, everyone must work to produce food. Even the children, the sick, and the elderly. The immediate consequences of the agricultural revolution were almost entirely negative. Life expectancy plummeted, the height of human beings decreased significantly, likely due to malnutrition. And speaking of malnutrition, babies weren't usually fed breast milk nearly as long as they were when humans were hunter-gatherers. Because of this, women could have children more frequently. As a part of the agricultural revolution, babies were not fed breast milk nearly as long as they were during the hunter-gatherer period. This is evidenced by the decrease in human height seen around the time of the agricultural revolution. Diseases of the bones and joints like arthritis also became more prevalent, also seen in the fossil record, and we got a new thing called pandemics. You're currently experiencing one. You see, pandemics didn't really happen before the agricultural revolution. We simply didn't have enough people in one place for a disease to spread as efficiently. On top of that, most diseases that break off into pandemics come from animals. They're zoonotic. Corona, and well, all forms of corona, are also zoonotic diseases, along with tuberculosis, Ebola, SARS, and many, many more. What the agricultural revolution, more accurately called the agricultural accident, would actually accomplish is allowing for more people to live on less land. And you might be asking, why would anyone ever take this deal? And the answer is, there was no deal. Roughly 18,000 years ago, 6,000 years before the agricultural revolution, the last ice age ended, meaning that the climate warmed and became more suitable for wheat plants. This meant that over time, thousands and thousands of years, wheat would become more prevalent in the places where we live. Wheat at this point was not a huge portion of anyone's diet. Wheat must be processed before it can be consumed, and so people would take the wheat with them. And inadvertently, they spread it all across the world. It was easier and made more sense to stay in the places where the wheat became more prevalent. And thus begins the agricultural accident. And this means that all of society was not created by human beings becoming more intelligent and learning how to farm. Society was created by accident. It's around the same time that the human brain and human jaw shrunk. In fact, the human jaw has shrunk so much today that most of us can't fit all of our teeth in our mouth. If you're an adult, you've probably had to have your wisdom teeth removed, or you may have not even grown wisdom teeth. So long as we're on the topic of lies, you were probably taught in school that there is but one type of natural selection. Individual selection, the kind that Charles Darwin writes about in On the Origin of Species. This is when brown-furred squirrels are more suited to an environment than our black-furred squirrels. And so, after a few generations, the brown ones have outcompeted all of the black-furred squirrels. And soon, all you see are brown squirrels. There are at least 5 different types of natural selection. The one that's very important for humans, though, is group selection. In group selection, the group decides what traits should be passed on and what traits should not be passed on. This is most easily seen in groups of chimpanzees. Groups of chimpanzees have a male chimpanzee at the head of the hierarchy. It's often thought that the top chimp is simply the most violent or domineering chimpanzee, but if the leading chimpanzee is too domineering, then the females who live below him will murder him. Human beings typically feel a similar way about the more violent members of society. Human beings also routinely rule out the most aggressive members of society. Today, in nearly every society on Earth, murder is illegal. And most religions have extensive sins about violence. An eye for an eye, written originally in Hammurabi's code nearly 4,000 years ago, was written to reduce violence. And today, if you think of a particularly violent person, then you probably feel a feeling of slight disgust. And that's not accidental. That was programmed. Humans, by all scientific definition, are domesticated. Except we are self-domesticated, unlike our cattle and our sheep, but not unlike our dogs. Roughly 27,000 years ago, wolves began following around our ancestors. It's thought that the more docile of the wolves were able to get close to our ancestors and eat some of their scraps and eventually become pets. But the way that they became pets was due to the fact that they outcompeted their more aggressive, better hunting counterparts. The most successful way to be a wolf and pass down your genetics was to be more docile, meaning that humans didn't really domesticate dogs, wolves domesticated themselves into dogs. Although growing fond of their companions, humans did eventually intervene, and now we have breeds like Max, a German Shepherd. And thank you for watching. I know this was a weird episode. It was out of my comfort zone. I hope it wasn't out of yours. Section, there will be linked a link to my Discord server. And if you sign up now, you can get the role of founder. This role is for the first 100 people on the server. When I'm monetized, I'll add the role of subscriber as well. Until then, I also have a Patreon, and like and subscribe if you liked this video. And thank you for watching.